numerical superiority of Britain and America. The Royal Air Force can trace its roots back to March 1912, when the formation of the Royal Flying Corps was approved. The force entered the First World War with the prime function of providing aerial observation for the ground forces, but soon progressed to air-to-air fighting. A further development saw aircraft designed to carry small bombs. The Royal Flying Corps embraced this progress, along with the other nations involved in the conflict. The early years of pioneering aerial combat were fought in flimsy aircraft that had none of the comforts of later years. The pilots were daring and resilient individuals who quickly earned respect for their bravery. They were seen as gentlemen as well as pilots, and an air of chivalry existed even at this treacherous time. By the end of hostilities in 1918, Britain would have the largest air force in the world, with a total number of 3,300 aircraft. One significant change had taken place earlier in the last year of the First War, when the Royal Flying Corps was renamed the Royal Air Force. The Royal Air Force would continue to develop and expand during the 1920s and 1930s, despite opposition from the longer established Navy and Army. Entry into this new service was strict, and only the best applicants were chosen. This would become a trademark of the Royal Air Force. Theories on the future of aerial warfare, based on the experiences of pilots during the First World War, were developed during this period. The Royal Air Force felt that the bomber would be the biggest menace to an enemy during any future conflict. It was felt that the bomber could breach any defences and deliver death and destruction on its enemy. As the development of the aeroplane gathered pace, however, it was realised that enemy bombers too would be capable of delivering a knockout blow against Britain, and the only countermeasure was its ability to carry out significant offensive operations over enemy homeland. The Royal Air Force developed its aircraft and training during the latter part of the 1930s, and in 1936, the expansion of this arm of service began in earnest. In July 1936, the Royal Air Force established separate commands that would be responsible for different areas of the air war strategy. The separate commands were Fighter Command, Bomber Command, Coastal Command, and Training Command. As developments on the continent unfolded, priority was given to the manufacture of fighter planes. This move brought opposition from Bomber Command, but it was a decision that would actually help prepare and equip Britain with the tools that would prevent her defeat during the Battle of Britain in 1940. Once this victory was assured, the development of the bomber progressed at a fast pace. What lay ahead for Britain was unclear at this stage of the war, and this period is remembered as one of the darkest in Britain's history. The Royal Air Force, however, remained professional and focused at this uncertain time. The aim was clear: the defeat of Germany. With this determination and the window of opportunity to develop their aircraft following their recent victory, the RAF would soon become established as the world's leading air force, one that other nations would try to emulate, but never match. America's use of aircraft for military purposes can also be traced back to the years before the First World War. Indeed, they were the first nation to purchase and evaluate aircraft for military use. The Americans were pioneers in some important fields. In 1910, they were the first to attempt dropping bombs from aircraft, In 1912, they were the first to install bomb sights on military planes. Despite this, America was unenthusiastic about the bomber, and little progress was made following its conception. America did set up the US Army Air Arm, but would only have 20 planes available for use when the First World War started. The Americans entered the First World War in 1917, and although aircraft would not see action over the battlefields of Europe until the spring of 1918, they would have 740 aircraft on hand by the end of the war. The Americans would try to follow the lead set by Britain. They would also run into similar opposition from the Army and Navy when expanding their air force. The period immediately following World War I would see a dramatic scaling down of the American armed services, but this did not prevent further developments being made to their military aircraft. America would lead the way in developing newer monoplanes with enclosed cockpits and radio equipment. They also manufactured twin-engine planes that were considered safer. By the outbreak of the Second World War in Europe, America was coming of age. Her aircraft design had moved on significantly, and she had developed some excellent aircraft, particularly the B-17. Although America had remained neutral in the early stages of the conflict, she was aware of the increasing threat from Japan and helped Britain, her ally, with financial aid. Furthermore, agreements were made between the two countries detailing their possible joint involvement in the war. The US Army Air Corps disagreed with the Allies on how to tackle the enemy. They had been observing British operations and felt that daylight raids would achieve greater accuracy than at night, and they were sure that their heavily armed bombers could protect themselves during these daylight operations. The Americans changed the name of their air force to the US Army Air Force in 1942. They would have a hard task ahead of them during the Second World War, but like their British counterparts, they were well led by very capable commanders. They also had the distinct advantage of immense industrial resources that would churn out vast quantities of war materials. At the end of the conflict, America would find herself in the position of having one of the strongest air forces in the world. One man will always be associated with Bomber Command and the bombing campaign over Germany, Sir Arthur Harris. Assuming command in 1942, he had three predecessors: Air Chief Marshal Sir Edgar Ludlow Hewitt, who was in command at the start of 1940, his replacement, Marshal of the Royal Air Force Sir Charles Portal, who remained in his post until the 5th of October 1940, and Air Marshal Sir Richard Pearse. As soon as Pearse took over, he was given new directives for the continuation of the bombing campaign. These included the destruction of Germany's oil production facilities and other targets of opportunity. This was amended in January 1941, when oil-producing targets were given priority. March saw yet another change, when the target became the German U-boat pens and shipbuilding facilities. These changes showed not only the lack of resources available to the RAF at this stage of the war, but also the scope of the threat that Britain faced on all fronts. It was around this time that the attacks on civilian targets were tentatively introduced. Owing to the inaccuracy of the bombing raids, this was deemed a more effective use of bomber firepower. In November 41, Pearse oversaw the biggest raid on Berlin to date, when 392 planes bombed the German capital.